The pleural sac is a serous membranous sac which is lined by the mesothelia, derivative of the mesoderm. It is present on the both sides of the thoracic cage. During development, as the lung buds are developing, the lung buds from the medial side of that side would invaginate the pleural sac. Due to this invagination, the pleural sac now envelops the lung bud as such. And hence, the two layers of the pleural sac can be seen. One layer, which completely encapsulates around the lung surface, is the visceral pleura. And another, which lies outside and towards the thoracic cage, lining the thoracic wall, is the parietal pleura. The orientation of both the pleura, that is visceral pleura and parietal pleura, would be different for the two sides. This is majorly due to presence of the cardiac notch in the left lung. Let's start from the left lung first. The left visceral pleura has majorly 8 points for its surface marking anteriorly. The first point would rise about 2.5 cm above the medial 1/3 of the clavicle. The second point would be at the left side of the sternoclavicular joint. Third point moving down at the angle of Lewis at its left side. Tracing down just at the margin of the post costal cartilage articulating with the sternum marks the fourth point. Left lung has a unique cardiac notch, and as a result, there will be about 3.5 cm lateral shift for the fifth point into the fourth intercostal space. Following downwards, 4 cm till the sixth costal cartilage would be the sixth point. Seventh point would be present at the sixth intercostal space alongside the mid-clavicular line. So firstly, we have a y-axis represented by the mid-clavicular line and an x-axis, that is the sixth intercostal space. This will mark the seventh point. The eighth point would be marked by the mid-axillary line corresponding to the 8th intercostal space. This would be the 7th rib, this would be the 8th rib, and hence here would be the 8th intercostal space. The 9th point lies posteriorly into the 10th intercostal space as its y-axis, and its x-axis, and with its y-axis demarcated by the lateral border of the erector spinae muscle. Joining all the points, we get the visceral pleura for the left lung. The visceral pleura on the right lung is slightly more simpler due to the lack of the cardiac notch on the right lung. The first point is similar. That is, it is 2.5 cm above the medial 1/3 of the clavicle bone. Second point is also similar at the junction, or you can say the joint of the sternoclavicular joint, at its right side. Third point, the right side of the angle of Lewis. Fourth point would be traced down till the sixth costal cartilage. The fifth point is marked by a y-axis and an x-axis again. The x-axis would be the sixth intercostal space, and the y-axis would be the mid-clavicular line. The sixth point would be marked by the y-axis taken as the mid-axillary line and the x-axis at the 8th intercostal space. Again posteriorly into the 10th intercostal space and the lateral border of the erector spinae muscle. Anteriorly we can join all the points to get along with the right lung. The parietal pleura of both the lungs are somewhat similar. They will trace the visceral pleura throughout, only differing at the diaphragmatic pleura. We'll come to that later. Firstly, the parietal pleura is tracing every single aspect of the visceral pleura as such. However, at its lower aspect, if we talk about the visceral pleura as it terminates in the midclavicular line at the 6th intercostal space, the same parietal pleura would be terminating into the 8th intercostal space. Similar is the case for the 8th intercostal space. If the visceral pleura is terminating in the mid-axillary line, then in the mid-axillary line, the parietal pleura shall terminate into the 10th intercostal space. Posteriorly, it was terminating the visceral pleura in the 10th intercostal space at the lateral border of erector spinae muscle. Hence, the parietal pleura would be terminating below the 12th rib, joining all these points, we get the parietal pleura. So a simple relation is that parietal pleura, specifically the diaphragmatic parietal pleura, is directed about 2 intercostal space below the visceral pleura. Coming back to the parietal pleura, the parietal pleura can be divided into 4 types based on their location. We have the cervical pleura, the costal pleuras, the diaphragmatic pleura, and the mediastinal pleura. The 2 pleuras would communicate at its medial side or its mediastinal surface. Not related to the surface anatomy, but by this figure, we can easily localize the nerve supply of the 2 pleuras. Firstly, we talk about the visceral pleura. The visceral pleura is developed from the splanchnopleuric mesoderm. As a result, it is having an autonomic nervous supply. Sympathetic supply ranges from T2 to T5, whereas parasympathetic supply is majorly from the vagus nerve. Coming towards the parietal pleura, it develops from the somatopleuric mesoderm. Hence, it has to have somatic nerve supply. We had divided the parietal pleura into 4 segments: cervical, costal pleura, diaphragmatic pleura, and the mediastinal pleura. The cervical pleura and the entire costal pleura, alongside the lateral aspect of the diaphragmatic pleura, these segments would be supplied by the intercostal nerves. While the mediastinal pleura and the medial part of the diaphragmatic pleura, we know that the phrenic nerve has its initial root values of C4, C5. These play a major role in brachial plexus and cervical plexus. As a result, damage or irritation to the parietal pleura in these regions will produce referred pain into the neck and the shoulder region. Referred pain from these regions, that is cervical, costal, and lateral part of diaphragmatic pleura, would have radiations, that is referred pain, into the abdomen. due to atypical nerve fibers ranging from T7 to T11.